Now we're going to go through bone growth after birth, postnatal bone growth. It happens in two ways. We increase the length of our long bones, which enables us to get taller and longer through interstitial growth. That's what we're going to look at in the first part of this video. We can also increase the thickness of all of our bones with appositional growth. That just involves osteoblasts in the periosteum and endosteum adding bone to thicken it. Osteoclasts will take away some bone to keep bone light. We'll see this a little later on in the video, but let's start with interstitial growth, how we increase the length. So interstitial growth increases the length of long bones. All of these zones listed here, we're going to look at on the next slide, they all exist in the epiphyseal plate. Recall this epiphyseal plate is hyaline cartilage where growth takes place, specifically interstitial growth. So here is the thickness of the epiphyseal plate. It's magnified. Let's see all these zones here of chondrocytes or cartilage cells. Here they're not doing much. They're just resting, but as they get pushed down, they start to divide. They undergo mitosis. The new cells get pushed down even further towards the diaphysis, where they start enlarging in the hypertrophic zone. Then they start breaking down and calcifying in the calcification zone. Now this calcification gets taken away by osteoclasts and bone or cells that clean up debris. And now that space that is made is filled in with osteoid from osteoblasts secreting bone matrix where the calcified cartilage once was. And this keeps happening, and the new bone just gets pushed into the diaphysis, elongating the diaphysis. And this will keep happening until you're done growing. At that point, cartilage cell mitosis will stop, and this bone growth area will just kind of start to take over the entire epiphyseal plate until all we're left with is an epiphyseal line. So with interstitial growth, bone is added into the diaphysis from the epiphyseal plate, elongating the long bone. With appositional growth, we have bone being added to the outside of compact bone by osteoblasts, and bone gets resorbed by osteoclasts in the interior. So the bone gets wider, but it stays light by increasing the size of this medullary cavity. We can tell this x-ray is of a child because we can see no bone between the epiphysis and the diaphysis. This space right here is actually the growth plate or epiphyseal plate, meaning this bone still has to elongate, and that will continue to happen till bone totally fills the space here and becomes an epiphyseal line. These are the hormones that regulate bone growth. The hormones listed here, growth hormone, thyroid hormone, testosterone, and estrogen, all will increase the rate or stimulate bone growth. One side note here with estrogen and testosterone is once you get to late adolescence and early adulthood, well, that same hormone that caused or stimulated bone growth will actually stimulate the closure of the epiphyseal plate, which will end the lengthening of long bones. Bone remodeling will keep occurring through your entire life. It's dealing with adding bone, bone deposit, and taking away bone, bone reabsorption, at the linings, at the periosteum and endosteum, based typically on how much stress is put on the bone. Bone will be added where there's more stress put onto it. So bone continues to remodel throughout life, where 4 years from now, your spongy bone will be completely different than it was previously. Takes longer for compact bone to achieve that same result. So don't forget this word, resorption. That's the job of the osteoclasts. It means to break down bone. Osteoclasts have special enzymes that they secrete, which will break down the organic matrix of bone. That dissolved matrix is then transcytosed, which means taken in by the cell at one end, and travels to the other end of the cell where it leaves the osteoclast and enters your body fluid and then into your blood. Now, there's a reason why we might want to do that, and I'll continue that. The important point here is that calcium is extremely important in the blood. Your body monitors the calcium level in the blood and will do whatever it can to keep homeostasis of calcium in the blood, meaning if blood calcium gets too low, it's going to take it from the bone and put it into the blood. So it's like it doesn't really care how much calcium is in the bone. What's really important is the calcium levels in the blood. Why? Well, calcium in the blood affects all of these things listed here, which are vital life functions. So let's see how calcium in the blood is regulated and how that involves bone. This mechanism here is important when blood calcium levels fall. So here we have a balance, blood calcium level is normal, but if it falls, now this is dangerous. So the message is sent to the parathyroid glands, which are these four little glands on the backside of the thyroid gland. The parathyroid gland will release a hormone, conveniently called the parathyroid hormone, or PTH. What does PTH do? It tells the osteoclasts, start doing your job. So it activates the osteoclasts. And what do the osteoclasts do? Well, they resorb bone. They take that calcium from the bone matrix and put it into the blood, where it's going back to homeostasis here, where it should be. So the body will sacrifice bone calcium in order to get blood calcium at the correct level. Important points here, this happens when blood calcium is low. Blood calcium is low, not bone calcium. When blood calcium is low, the parathyroid gland releases parathyroid hormone. That hormone activates the osteoclasts to resorb bone matrix and dump that calcium into the blood to raise the calcium level there. And we'll end this video with Wolf's Law, and has to do with remodeling. It says that bone will grow where there's force placed on it. So whatever hand you are, left or right, that bone will be thicker, stronger in your arm. Curved bones are the thickest where they're most likely to buckle. So where the stress points are on the bone, that's where it's the thickest. Trabeculae, which is the bone part of spongy bone, are the lines of stress. Bone projections that we've went over in previous videos are a result of stress put on those projections because ligaments and tendons are pulling on them. So the point is, bones are smart. They'll add bone where the stress is put on it, in order to keep it strong. This is your thigh bone, which is your femur, and we see these large projections on it. That's because your large leg muscles are pulling on the bone in order to move you around. And where those tendons attach, we see projections. That's Wolf's Law. Wherever there's more stress, compression, or tension, there'll be bone laid down in a specific way to counteract all of these forces.